Okay, right now we're going to go into the topic of handling inside products. This is very important because we see people all the time with emotional problem, have negative thoughts, negative subconscious mind, all kinds of problems, interpersonal problem, sleeping problem, health problem. Many people have all kinds of problems, marriage problems. We all have problematic people around us, right? Including us. We have problems too. But I actively take care of these problems. Now, one time, God spoke to me through one experience. After I experienced the Holy Spirit, after a period of time, I start to have joy every time I pray. So for the whole day long, I pray with joy. Now, why did I start to pray like this? Why did I start to have joy all day long? It came from one time when I hear a Bible passage. You know, I listen to the Bible all the time. When I'm doing other things, I will listen to the Bible. One time I hear this Bible verse, you all know, Matthew 25. Jesus said to the man with the 5 talents who earned 5 talents. And Jesus said to him, "You're a good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a few things." Suddenly I heard that verse, faithful in a few things. This person is the most faithful one. The one with the 5 talents, who earned 5 talents, is the most faithful one. And Jesus said, "You have been faithful in a few things." I said, "How come a few things?" Jesus should have said, "You have been faithful in many things." But then I think, you know, this thought came to me. Maybe in most people's mind, for the whole day, sometimes they're busy, they're burdened, they may be unhappy, and they think about other things, even preparing sermon, we might be just preparing sermon as an exercise, not as a relationship with God. Now, it's good to prepare sermon while thinking about God. Oh, hallelujah! Oh, Jesus! Hallelujah! What do the people need? Oh, how can I let the word of God touch their life? So when we prepare sermon, it's best to let God works in our life. But some people, for the whole day when they, even when they serve God, even when they praise and worship, they're looking about the music, looking at the music, looking about, you know, the instruments, what they can do. In that way, their mind is not really on God. So this thought came to me. And then God let me know, if I stay in the presence of God all day long, loving God, worshiping God, appreciating God, and praying for other people, when I do that for a whole day long, maybe one day when I see Jesus, Jesus will still say, "You've been faithful in a few things, but more things than in the past." You got the point? I want to be faithful in more things. Maybe in God's mind is still a few things, but at least more than in the past. Now this is how God speaks to me. That in different ways, in Bible verses, also in people's lives, God speaks to me how to handle different problems. So I said, okay, I want to praise God and think about God all day long. So I have this habit. Even in very noisy environment, I'll be thinking about God. Oh, hallelujah. And I'll be worshiping Him from my heart. And that's very important. And it keeps me from having negative thoughts. I still have negative thoughts sometimes, but I can detect the negative thoughts very quickly. I can detect the negative emotions very quickly because I'm in a very positive, joyful mentality most of the time. And then one time I shared with someone about my experience of the Holy Spirit. I called out the person and I shared. But that person did not accept the work of the Holy Spirit. And she was angry. She was unhappy. And after I handed the phone, I was affected by her and I prayed. I found that I lost the joy. I said, "There's something wrong. I have to do something." So I called her again. Now I did not do anything wrong, but I said, "If I made you unhappy, please I didn't do anything wrong, but if I made her unhappy, please forgive me. And she was still angry. But after I hanged up, I said, I already apologized. I already did what I can do. I can rejoice again. I can put it down. So after that, I pray again. I feel the joy of the Lord again. Now in this experience, God spoke to me. From now on, take care of every problem like that. When any problem comes up, take care of it. Right away. Don't wait. Right away. So I started to do that. And that was in 1998, shortly after I experienced the Holy Spirit. And I kept doing that. And that's how God helped me to be able to change my way of thinking, change my emotions, change my way of looking at people. God spoke to me many, many times. And then I work on these things, and I find that I can take care of sins and negative emotions, negative thoughts, negative subconsciousness gradually. When I take care of this instantly, and I find that it works. And the Bible said, guard your heart above all things. Guard your heart. Because from it, it's the wellspring of your life. It's come from it, the whole life. If we guard our heart. So I'm going to share briefly. This is actually a 1 week training. But I'm going to do it in 30 minutes. How to take care of different problems. And then you can ask me questions too. For instance, when I have negative emotions, when I feel unhappy, maybe because someone said something unpleasant to me, maybe I lost an opportunity to serve someone, to minister in a place. Maybe I lost some money, whatever it is, and I felt unhappy. And I noticed that I'm unhappy. So remember this 5 steps to victory. This morning I talked about 5 steps to victory. First, aware. I'm aware. I'm affected by the person, first. Second, destructive. You have to write this down if you haven't written it down. Second, destructive. This is destructive. It will destroy me, even though that person has sinned first. If this represents a person, this person has sinned first, and then I get angry. In God's eyes, it's still my sin, and his sin too. He has sinned, but I have sinned too. So I realize that I'm affected by the person, and then I will handle it with the Bible. So the third point is Bible. I'll say, okay, if I do anything wrong, I apologize. If I don't do anything wrong, it's this problem. I don't have to be affected by that. And then I will just ask God to help me. So the fourth point is prayer. And the fifth, I choose to obey God. I choose to bless. Let me share my experience with you. One time, you know, actually I know a Lutheran pastor who have experienced the Holy Spirit and who is open to the work of the Holy Spirit. And he has let me have a spirit-filled meeting in his church for a long time. And he introduced me to another person who is a lay person who has a special experience, and he does all kind of evangelistic meeting. But he doesn't accept the Holy Spirit, the work of the Holy Spirit. And one time he took me to meet another pastor who doesn't accept the Holy Spirit. And then I share about what I do. And one thing I said, one thing I do is revival. To me, this is the description of my work. But this man, okay, I call him A. This man who took me to see another pastor. Let me clarify. First, the Lutheran pastor who accepted the work of the Holy Spirit introduced me to a person, A. A introduced me to another pastor who doesn't accept the Holy Spirit, who serves in the mission field. So I hope maybe I can go there to bless the church. So I tell him, my ministry is training and revival and helping people. And then, but when A came back, he took pastor, this pastor, Lutheran pastor, and talked to me. He talked to me for about half an hour. He said, who do you think you are? Do you think you're greater than that pastor that you can bring revival? Do you think that he cannot bring revival? He you have to go and bring revival? Okay, when I hear that, I say, well, he doesn't accept the term revival. Maybe I have not used it right. Maybe he doesn't accept it. So I continue to be gentle with him. In my heart, I stay gentle and I listen to him. Okay? He doesn't accept it. It's okay. I'm sorry. That happened. And if I have a chance, you know, I will explain to him again. And I talk gently. And then this man went away. And this pastor said to me, he said, Pastor Yim, when I saw how you respond, I admire you. Now, I'm not saying I'm great, but I'm saying, in my heart, when I know that he is angry, that man A is angry, he doesn't accept the work of the Holy Spirit. It is his problem. So when he gets angry with me, it's not my problem. It doesn't mean I will stop using the word, you know, serve under the power of the Holy Spirit, but it is his problem. But for most people, if this person is A, you look at him, if he's angry, why did you say that to him? Most people say, well, that's true. Why do you ask me that? And then we get angry. But I stay being calm. Because it's not going to do anything good if I get angry. So in my heart, I distinguish his thoughts. I know that he cannot accept the work of the Holy Spirit. And I just let go. And I also learn to have compassion on people and say, he doesn't accept the work of the Holy Spirit and he cannot handle his anger, so that's why he gets angry. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's not going to hurt me. He cannot destroy God's plan in my life. That's one thought I have all the time. Nobody can destroy God's plan in my life. Can you say it? Nobody can destroy God's plan in my life. God is a wonderful plan in each one of our lives. God has a wonderful plan in each one of our lives. So I choose to be patient and kind to him and bless him and pray for him. The thing is to pray for him. Let me tell you, I was in a traditional church before. And I had to leave the traditional church after I experienced the Holy Spirit. Before I left, I was courageous to pray for people, even in a traditional seminary. That's what they knew about it. And they warned me. And one time, in a meeting, I thought nobody saw me, and then one of the Lutherans came to me and said, can you lay hand on me? So I lay hand on me, on that person. And somebody saw that and reported to the seminary. And the seminary said, you have broken the rule. That's how I was. And then, you know, and there was one person there who really wanted to persecute me, who gave me a hard time. And let me tell you, one time I had this thought, maybe God will judge that person. Maybe the person might have sickness. Maybe the person might have cancer. And God spoke to me, it's not for you to judge. I will judge. It's for you to bless. So I bless the person and say, Lord, please help that person to be faithful in her way. That she's faithful in her way. Even though she doesn't accept the Holy Spirit, she's faithful in her way. And then one day, the Lord will say, you are faithful and good servant. So I pray for her and say, Lord, please don't let sickness come to her. So that's how God handles my heart. Let me tell you another incident. One incident. I was in a pastor's meeting, and some pastors experience the Holy Spirit, and they share about how they do great things for God. And there was one traditional pastor there. And this traditional pastor shared about his ministry. But when he shared, it was not anything great. It was something small. When I heard that in my heart, I said, well, that's not anything great. God spoke to me. Who are you to judge? It's me who work in his life. It's me who work in your life. Who are you to judge? And immediately, I was convicted and I said, Lord Jesus, forgive me. All I have is from you. And every traditional church, every traditional pastor, every traditional Christian is also used by you. So whatever church I go by, I bless the church. Whether it's traditional or spirit-filled. That's how God handles different problems in my life. I don't want anything negative in me, any negative attitude in me. Now sometimes we might have an attitude like, oh, it's too hard. The ministry is too hard, no results, no money. And then we get frustrated. And I noticed that. And how do I handle that? I would say, well, this is God's ministry. God will take care of His ministry. God has His heart on ministry. If I do my part of trusting God and His faithful, then God will bless the ministry. It's not for me to worry about ministry. So I said to myself, it is God's ministry. I just do my part and let go. Hallelujah, I do my part. Hallelujah, let God do the rest. And that way, I relax and have no burdens. When I preach, I relax. And I find that when I relax, I have better results. When I counsel people, when I help people, when I relax, I have better results. Let me share about subconscious mind. And just now talk about, you know, actually, this is just a condensed version about any negative thoughts, any negative emotions. Negative subconscious mind. We all have negative subconscious mind from our childhood on. Because people have said negative things to us all the time. And as people have said many times, you're no good. You're not doing well. You're foolish. You're stupid. You're too slow. People said this thing all the time. So in our heart, we become sensitive. One time in my church in the past, in the front there, where the musical instruments are, there was a cheer group there. And I said to the people, they were students. At that time, I ministered to students. And I said to them, in the future, when we see a chair like that, take that away. And one girl said to me, I didn't do it. She said, I didn't do it. I never said she did it. But she said, I didn't do it. Why? Because in her family, every time there's something wrong, the mother would say, it's your fault. You did it. So it's in her subconscious mind, whenever there's anything wrong, it is her fault. So she has to protect herself and say, I didn't do it. Did you catch that? Does it happen to you too? If something goes wrong, we might have a tendency to see the same. It's not my fault. I didn't do it. Because in a subconscious mind, we have a strong guilt feeling. It's in our subconscious mind that if something is wrong, it's always my fault. So we have this subconscious mind. It's very hard to heal a negative subconscious mind. Some people, they always say negative things. I don't know if you know any negative people. I use an illustration. Husband and wife. If the wife is very negative, the husband said to the wife, I'll take you out tonight. The wife would say, is anything wrong? Why do you take me out? What do you want to get from me? Now sometimes, because the woman is not used to being loved, then she will always respond in a negative way. And then when the husband doesn't take her out, and she will say, you never took me out. You never take care of me. You never listen to me. So when the husband do something good or do something bad, the wife always complains. Have you seen people like that? Because in the mind is always, nobody is good. Nobody treats me well. Nobody sees me as important. Let me ask you, do you have this negative thought in you? I tell you, I do have that for many years. I tell you, when I was a child, when my parents divorced, And my father has a stepmother. And when she came, there was a lot of yelling in the family. And I started to have nightmares. And I walked in my dream. Did you walk in a dream, some of you? In the middle of the night, you have nightmares, and then you suddenly walk, jump from the bed, or do something. It happened to me for years. I tell you, I had this negative subconscious mind for years. Now, how do you change the negative subconscious mind? The way to cure that is to continue to have the blessings of God. To continue to say, God loves me. I'm important in the sight of God. God blesses me. God sees me as important. God is a wonderful man in my life. And would you believe all this? Let me use an illustration of my wife. My wife has a very healthy subconscious mind. Whenever I do anything to her, this is how she responds. Wow, I'm so happy! If I, one day I said to her, tonight do you have time? And then she said, what do you want to do? I said, I want to take you out for a walk. And she said, for the whole day I'm very happy. And she always responded like a little child. Oh, she laughed. She's very happy all the time. But some people cannot laugh like that. When somebody is nice to them, they'll say, what do you want to get for me? Because they have a negative subconscious mind. Now, if somebody has a negative subconscious mind, how can you cure them? The way is to continue to say, the Lord loves me. I can believe I'm important. I can learn to like myself. Can you say to yourself, I like myself in Jesus. I like myself in Jesus. I am precious. I am precious. I am important. Even though I myself am nobody, but God raises me up. I become someone important. But we have to do this many, many times to continue to believe that, and then we can become more and more positive. Now let me ask you, do you have people who are negative around you? When anything is wrong, they say, oh, we cannot fix it. It's too hard. Now if we are like that, when we see any problem, for instance, somebody says, let's do a crusade. The first thing some people think is, oh, we have no money. We cannot do it. Somebody will be against it. What will? No result. All these negative thoughts come out. But some people, it's always negative reaction. When we notice that we are like that, we ask God, is it true? Is it true that no good result will come out from that? Is it true that we cannot do it? So we use the 5-step to victory. I'm aware. I have negative subconscious mind. It always comes up to be negative. The subconscious mind means that we are not aware of it. It's underneath our consciousness. But it always shows up. The subconscious mind is like an iceberg in water. The tip of it comes out. Sometimes our emotions come out. It shows that we have an unhealthy subconscious mind. And you change it. How do we change it? We are aware. Remember, aware, 5-step of victory, and then it's destructive. If we are negative, it's destructive. Let me ask you this question. Are you negative in some ways? Have you met negative people? How many positive people are there around you? How many positive people are there around you? Not too many, right? Not too many. I learned to be positive. I tell you, I was not born like this. In my childhood, I was always mistreated. So it's negative experiences. But I started to change myself by always declaring God's grace. I'm aware of the negative things, and then it's destructive, and then I use the Bible. God loves me, God cares about me, and believe that He's around me, serving me, ministering to me, and then I pray to God, Lord, help me. And then I choose to believe, yes, I'm important in the sight of God. Can you say this? Yes, I'm important in the sight of God. Yes, I'm important in the sight of God. Yes, I can do great things for God. Yes, I can do great things for God. Everything is possible with God. Everything is possible. that. So we learn to change the subconsciousness so that we become positive and joyful and happy and relaxed. Many ministers or people who serve God are not so relaxed because we are under pressure. We are under pressure to bring many people to church. We are under pressure to bring money to the church. So we are under pressure. But when we say, it's God who provides. The more we trust God, the more He will provide. The more we worry, the less joy we'll have. And people see that the pastor has no joy, then the people will not give so much. But when they see the pastor is always joyful, hallelujah! They see the pastor is relaxed and loving and kind, they will be more devoted to this church. They see there's a future in the church. They see the future in the ministry. They see the pastor really is devoted to helping people and blessing people and raising up people for the kingdom of God. So, one question in the morning is, how can we build the local church? To build the local church is very important. The pastor is filled with the Holy Spirit, full of joy, full of relaxation, have faith in God, and glorify God all the time, and bless people, and pay attention to people, and have a goal, a vision of the church. And when people join the church, he will tell them, this is our vision. Do you want to join this vision? To bless this area. Like our group, they know our vision. To bless different countries. To go and train people. And they follow that vision, and they are devoted to that. So when we have a vision, people will follow us. When we take care of our negative subconscious mind. Every time when we change our way of thinking, our mind will become more positive. Every time. Now this is very important teaching. Say it after me. Every time you declare something positive from God, every time you declare something positive from God, our subconsciousness will have healing. Our subconsciousness will have healing. The more we declare, the more healing we'll have. Gradually, your mind is changed. Have you noticed your mind has changed since you were converted? Since you were converted, your mind has changed a lot, right? But still, we have a lot of garbage, right? A lot has changed already, but still a lot of garbage. But if we take care of each of these garbage one at a time, whenever anything comes up, and we take care of that, then our life will become more and more joyful. Hallelujah. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? So for me, I always help my co-workers, all my students, to take care of negative thoughts, negative emotions, negative subconsciousness, and negative lifestyles. Like some people sleep very late, eat junk food. This is not healthy lifestyle. Or argue with the wives all the time, not healthy lifestyle. When they change to have a healthy lifestyle, then and they feel the Holy Spirit, then this person will be changed from inside out. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Now, the key to this is, when you notice it, you're aware of it, take care of it right away. Don't let negative thoughts stay. Now, why do sometimes we let negative thoughts stay? If this represents a person who is negative, he says something negative to me, and then we might say, I'm unhappy. He said that to me, it's unfair. We say, it's unfair. I have to do something back. So in our heart, we feel it's unfair. We have to do something back. And this thought, actually, is Satan's way to take something more from you. But if you say, it's okay to be unfair. Jesus was treated unfairly on the cross. Jesus was treated unfairly in his ministry. It's okay to be unfair. If he hurts me, it's his problem. He has, when he's standing in front of God, he will be in a bad condition. I don't have to be affected by him. Then our mind will be calm. But let me use this illustration. Many wives or husbands, like the husband says something bad, and the wife says, he says something bad. Tonight I'm not going to sleep with him. Tonight, I'm not going to cook him dinner. I'm going to yell at him. I'm going to stare at him. We feel that when we do something like this, we get something back. Is this right? Do we get something back? No. We only get hatred back. So it's foolish thoughts we have. Many people have foolish thoughts in our mind. God has shown me many of these foolish thoughts, ungodly thoughts. And I realize it doesn't have to be fair. It's okay for us to bless our husband or wife, even when they are not good. And we can say, if I treat him nice, maybe one day he will change. The only way to change non-Christian husband or non-Christian wife is to love them so much that they'll change gradually. Okay? Now I open up for questions. Because if you learn this way of life, this lifestyle, your life will totally change. If you learn to take care of negative thoughts, emotions, subconsciousness, personality problems, if you learn to take care of this when they come up. Now sin we're talking about, I don't repeat that, but sin is the same thing. When any sin come up, we say this is destructive. And use the Bible to apply to it, and then pray, and then choose not to sin. Choose because sin will destroy. Sin will take away God's perfect plan. You look at me and use an illustration. For now God has given me many good teachings. My ministry can grow stronger and stronger. I can bless more people. But I don't have to think of number. I don't have to think of large needs. I just want to raise up more people to serve God. But if you one day you hear that Pastor Yeh has committed adultery, what will happen? My ministry will be destroyed. Or Pastor Yeh blows up. He's full of anger. Then people will say, I don't want to hear you. So if I sin, it will destroy God's plan in my life. Do you want to destroy God's plan in your life? I hope you say, I want to keep God's plan and go to the most perfect plan of God, to be used by God. Do you have this motivation? Do you want to be used by God greatly? Do you want to waste your life? I use an illustration. If you go to the, you know, somewhere, and you see people go to the ocean and they just throw money into the ocean. You say, what are you doing? Why are you throwing money away? I tell you, when Christians sin, you are throwing your life away. When Christians live in negative mentality, it's like you are throwing away money all the time. Our life is very precious. And when we're lazy and don't do anything to serve God, we are also throwing away money. We're throwing away the blessings of God. You have any question how to handle certain problems? Now some of you might have a very unpleasant husband or wife. You say, that's hard, too hard, too hard. I tell you, it is hard. It is hard. But if you persevere and say, if my husband or wife gets angry with his problem, I continue to bless him. And I'll give him water and say, you can drink the water. I'll give you a massage. Are you willing to do that to your husband or wife? Even when he's not nice, I'll give you a massage. I bought you some good food. But in your heart, you might have this unwillingness, right? Where does this unwillingness come from? It came from a sinful nature. Very often, we are not willing. It's not that we don't know what to do. We are not willing. And that's why many Christians waste their life. Now, let me tell you, this message, I know it's different from most of the message. I know in Africa, you don't hear a message like that. Mostly you hear, hallelujah, we want to serve God. I'm speaking to your mind and spirit now. I hope you accept this message and learn to apply it. My question is, do you think you know how to apply it? The five steps of victory. Aware, is it destructive, viable to apply, pray, and choose. Even though my heart doesn't want to do it, but I will change my heart. Yes, I want to bless my husband or wife. I want to do something nice. And that way, God is pleased with you. God will be happy with you. And God will bless you. And you will be full of joy and freedom. You look at me, I'm full of freedom. I'm totally free. But let me tell you, I do face problems. I do face problematic people. When I face problematic people, I'll tell you, I apologize a lot. I will keep telling the person, I do care about you, I want to help you. You know, I do see a problem. I want to talk about that, I want to handle that. But I care about you, that's why I talk about it. I do it because I love you, I care about you. So I handle negative people, negative problems. Okay, do you have any questions about this? I hope this will speak to your heart. And you will start to apply it. Remember this 5-step of victory. And if you have more questions, you can ask me afterwards. Let's rise and pray. Jesus, help us to become aware of these negative thoughts in our mind now. Do you have negative thoughts toward your husband or wife now? Do you have negative thoughts toward your ministry, toward your members or your pastor now? Do we have anything negative inside? You ask God to speak to you and help you to handle it. Oh Lord Jesus, I need you. Jesus, I need you to clear me of garbage so we will guard our hearts. For it is the wellspring of our life. Our whole life comes from the heart. If we have a free heart, a joyful heart, a burdenless heart, our life will be different. Oh Lord Jesus, help us. Set us free. Set my spirit free, that I may worship you. Set my spirit free, that I may bless your name. Let all bondage go, that I may be set free. Set my spirit free to worship you. If our spirit is free, we can bless many people. Say, Lord, please help me. Put down my negative thoughts. Put down my negative emotions. Put down my negative subconscious mind. Be filled with the love of God all the time. Be filled. Is easy. My burden is light. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. When we come to Him, Jesus is wonderful. He has so much to do, but He's always without burden. Jesus has so much to do, but He's always free and joyful and full of love. Jesus, you're so wonderful! And Jesus raised up sinful people to be used by Him. He changed sinful people to be used by Him. That, to me, is a very wonderful work of God. God uses weak people, change them, use them mightily for His kingdom. Thank you, Father. Please help us. Take away our burdens, our sadness, our negative emotions, negative thoughts, so that we are carefree. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! I can feel joy, down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I can feel joy, down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. I can feel joy, down in my heart. Down in my heart. Joy, 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 joy awareness of consciousness, you have to